The difficult IV placement happens to everyone, but when performed by an experienced practitioner, it can appear to be deceptively easy. In fact, it is a very highly technical skill that requires a lot of knowledge, actually, as well as considerable practice. Now, the ability to obtain intravenous access through cannulation of a peripheral vein is an essential skill in medicine and in anesthesiology in particular. In fact, a peripheral IV access must be had for administration of anesthesia. Peripheral IV allows you to access the circulation, allows you to sample blood, infuse fluids and IV medications. And there are several different methods how you can facilitate an IV placement in difficult patients, such as illumination or ultrasound. However, today I will teach you one technique that is very little known, and it is sufficient for peripheral vein cannulation and much faster than ultrasound in most instances. On the start of your operating day in the morning, your first patient is in the operating room 8, and it comes with a 10 to 15 minute delay. As the patient is being wheeled in the operating room, the nursing staff report that the patient is late because they were not able to place an IV and they've had multiple attempts and difficulty, and therefore they brought the patient to the operating room, albeit with a delay. But by the time the patient is in the operating room and in the operating bed, it's already 8:20 and the surgeons are now starting to fret about the delay at the start of the day. Although this delay has nothing to do with you, as you know, it is always an anesthesia delay. As the patient is positioned on the operating room table, you assess the patient's peripheral veins and now you see that there are traces of multiple attempts. To increase the size and the visibility of the peripheral veins, we typically use tourniquet, and there are several different kinds of tourniquet you can use, but the idea with the tourniquet that you apply the compression around the arm or the leg so that the arterial inflow continues, but the venous outflow is prevented. So what that does, it causes engorgement of the peripheral veins. One better way to apply a tourniquet is to apply a blood pressure cuff and basically just set it at 90 millimeters of mercury or something below the diastolic pressure. Now, veins can be enlarged the better seen also by using several other methods. Most patients come into the operating room, have already fasted, they're dehydrated, they're frightened, scared, they have a very high sympathetic outflow. The operating room can be cold, and all of these factors together conspire to result in significant diminution of the peripheral veins. You can do several things to improve the venous flow and enlargement of the veins. The patient should immediately be warmed up by application of bear hugger or forced air warming devices, application of warm compresses, and things like that, but that really takes time. Now, no doubt you can also wheel in an ultrasound machine and use ultrasound for peripheral access, but the truth is, the ultrasound is not a great tool for small peripheral veins. It's great for deeper veins. And also, by the way, you would not make too many surgeons happy by wheeling in an ultrasound machine at the time where we already laid 20 to 25 minutes now. Instead, I will teach you a technique, which I call reverse S-mark, that will allow you to find an IV access, draw blood, or cannulate veins even in the most difficult patients. So here we have a patient in the operating room who is extremely cold, clammy extremities, and it's almost impossible to find a distal peripheral vein. So what we're going to do right now is actually we're going to use, you can see there are a couple of attempts here, but we can use this highly elastic rubber bandage. And we're going to apply first a tourniquet and slowly move that tourniquet towards the peripheral aspect of the extremity while squeezing the blood consistently towards the distal extremity. And here we go, we continue wrapping the extremity, we stretch and apply, stretch and apply, stretch and apply, until we get to the distal extremity. And as we start assessing the distal peripheral veins, we start tapping on the skin. The tapping on the skin causes the vasodilation because of the release of the inflammatory mediators. The inflammatory mediators then vasodilate the peripheral veins. Here we can clearly see a very nice peripheral vein that is accessible now for cannulation, something that previously we could not see. Now, here's another very important trick that we always do, is that is you want to bend that catheter, bend that needle, because bending the needle allows you to lift the needle up slightly, because the angle of insertion has to be very low, as these are very peripheral veins. And here we go now, the intravenous catheter is in. Okay, so here's another example. Again, another patient who was brought to the operative area, where you can see multiple attempts at venous puncture and IV line that went on unsuccessfully. So we're going to then now proceed to the placement on the other side here, where you can also see a few punctures that went on unsuccessfully. But the most important thing here is that the arm stays down, never elevated, because that would drain the blood from the upper extremity. You want the arm to hang down or be horizontal at least. And then we apply that first round with the S-mark bandage, which is for the tourniquet purposes. And then we're going to squeeze the blood more distally so that the blood from the deep veins actually pulls down and fills up the small peripheral veins distally. So here we go, stretch and apply. Stretch and apply. And keep going circularly. For this, we typically use an S-mark bandage that's anywhere between 10 and 15 centimeters wide. We keep on going diligently, because the diligence with which you apply this S-mark bandage is directly proportional with the success you're going to get with this particular technique. As you could see, we started seeing already some peripheral veins of the dorsal on the wrist and the hand. But typically the best veins that you get with this technique are either on the dorsal side or the volar side. Here we can see quite a few of them now, the volar side. And again, we tap that territory several times because that tapping releases inflammatory mediators. We stabilize the skin, we stretch the skin, and if anyhow possible, we pick the vein that has two contributories, because that's where the veins are fixed the best. Now the catheter enters into the vein, we have an immediate flashback, and there you go, another successful intravenous placement.